Hello everyone, welcome to our session. My name's George Heritage. I work in the Assessment Services Department in the Madrid office for Cambridge Assessment English. And this?
My name's Sarah Ellis and I work in the Assessment Services Department based in Italy. So we're actually live from Italy and Spain.
I forgot to mention that. Yeah, we are live from two countries at once. So fingers crossed everything works. How long have you been in Italy, Sarah?
I must admit, I came for a year and I've been here for over 30.
I think that's
near Florence in Tuscany, so I'm
often the way. I was here for a while, then I worked for Cambridge in assessment for a few years. I was lucky enough to work on the Young Learners Revision Project. So Young Learners exams hold a special place in my heart. And then back to Madrid.
And I've been lucky to work with a lot of teachers who are interested in young learners. So that's been great experience. And obviously recently doing webinars about young learner resources. So I'm delighted to be able to do this one with you today.
Me too. It's an honor. Well, welcome everybody. You'll probably have noticed we have one of the catchiest titles during the whole three-day event, Tips for Parents and Families Supporting Young Children Learning English at Home. We are well aware that the vast majority of you, our audience, are teachers. So obviously these are tips for you as teachers to pass on to parents and families. And we'll be looking at some resources that are originally designed sort of for teachers in the classroom, how we can use those and pass those on to our parents and families before moving on to things more specifically designed for parents. So, Sarah, what are we talking about?
So, this is a quick overview of what we're going to cover. We'll be looking at the challenges, both on the side of the teacher and the parents, and we'll also talk about the importance of creating an English learning space for the children.
We'll have a think about how to communicate effectively what we're aiming for, how to communicate that to our students and to parents, and then focusing. We're aware that we have a very short time and we would love to do a session on lots of different levels for different contexts, but we're going to be focusing mainly on younger learners and vocab and how we can get parents with perhaps a more limited command of English still helping their children at home.
And what we will do is cover lots of resources. And just to reassure you that at the end of the session, you will actually be given a link to some of those resources. And hopefully you'll be able to find there's quite a variety, digital and on the website.
I should pop up in the chat box. There's no need to take photos of our slides, etc. You will get a PDF with all of the resources that we mention. So, Sarah.
So, what are the challenges?
What are the challenges? They are many and varied. Would you like to kick off?
Yeah, perhaps the first one is actually to think about those children around the world who've been learning at home for quite a considerable length of time and perhaps are now transiting back to fully or partially back to the live classroom.
We'll have lots of students who have been in situations where, in some cases, I think a lot of the time, especially in a rushed way, a lot of teachers trying to replicate exactly what happened in the classroom at home, which sometimes works, sometimes doesn't. So they're going to have to readjust to being back in a face-to-face or a hybrid environment.
And of course, the other challenge is that many children have had different levels of access to the internet, perhaps have a different level of command of how to use digital tools and resources. And many children will have been in households where perhaps they're sharing their digital device as well to add to the challenge.
And alongside that, probably sharing space, not in all cases, but in many, children will have been at home whilst their parents are working from home. I'm sure many of you teachers have children you've been desperately trying to teach whilst your children are learning around you. Probably quite a lot of work has ended up being done on beds. I've definitely been in a few meetings with colleagues working from their beds. So again, getting them used to that transition back into the classroom. Moving
so let's
on,
have
Sarah.
A look at the challenges, particularly for parents supporting their children. I think one of the biggest is actually to do with if they can't speak English. So maybe they can't speak English or they've got a limited level of English. Of course, that makes it even more of a challenge.
Time, definitely, as we've mentioned, parents working from home, parents not working from home whilst their children have been at home. Time is always a big factor a big challenge to managing situations like this.
And of course, the access to digital resources and knowing how to use them. Not all parents will be tech savvy, not knowing how to use the internet, or maybe not having access to the internet. So that's also...
And confidence, along with maybe not speaking, well, speaking English, not speaking English, confidence in terms of the support that they're giving is useful, is fruitful. Are they supporting too much? Are they not supporting enough? Are they overlapping with teachers? So moving on to the challenges that you as teachers face, communicating with parents.
Continue for that, George, actually. Of course, one of the challenges is that parents don't have a teaching background. Many parents weren't, of course, and they don't perhaps know or understand what the best thing is for them to do.
Time as well, perhaps even more so. If you're a teacher with three classes of 30 students, that's 90 sets of parents to communicate with, and you want to try and communicate fairly and evenly with all of them.
And in fact, the problem of reaching out and communicating to parents may be that parents don't have technical skills, don't have access to digital devices. So what do you do? Of course, where they do have access to digital devices, you might be able to set up a WhatsApp group and to communicate with the parents of a particular class, but not everybody has that luxury.
And even in that situation, confidence as teachers communicating with parents, we've all had those difficult parents who are, you are the teacher, it's your job, what have I got to do with it? WhatsApp groups, for example, always there's absent parents who never answer anything. So we're aware that there are many challenges for you as well, communicating what needs to be done to parents. And the elephant in the room?
Yes,
Sarah?
It's the great unknown, George. What's that?
The great unknown. Well, many of you will have started back. I know here in Spain today, many teachers went back. Some of you won't know when you will be starting and what kind of form starting back is going to take. There are so many unknowns and variables. And I think when we do go back, what's it going to be like? Will children be wearing masks? Will you have reduced class sizes, socially distanced classrooms? Many things to take into account. And I think that has an effect on our confidence, but also...
It has an effect on children. And of course, many children are going back to school after a considerable time away from their friends, away from being with their teacher. Perhaps they're not feeling very confident. They're not confident about their level of English. And they're perhaps thinking, I don't know, I can't.
Hopefully, with the support from us as teachers and parents, we can turn that I can't into a great big we can. First things first, a great way to start this, Sarah, with students still at home or in a hybrid situation.
Absolutely. And this is looking at creating a learning space for English. I think creating a learning space for English so that they can actually associate that space with somewhere they go when they're learning English is very important and very impactful. Of course, it doesn't have to be an expensive thing to set up. It could just be a corner in a room. It might be a place on a table. You might use colour. So, for example, you might use a coloured table mat that you use when they're learning English. So they associate that mat with English. You might choose some objects that are associated with English to put around the space.
Fun objects, Sarah.
Absolutely.
And keep things colourful. Keep things playful and get their work up around. I think lots of visual support is essential, especially for little ones. And once they have this space, this place where they know this is English time, we need to make sure that we have routine. I think little and often is really important for younger learners, not 2 hours a day. And I'm talking about outside of English class. So set up 10 minutes a day, encourage parents, just 10 minutes of English time a day. Could be in the morning, could be in the afternoon, could be at tea time. What time do you have your tea, Sarah?
Now that's a very important question, George. Well, I do know that the Queen has tea at 4 o'clock. So
4 o'clock.
I better say I have it at 4 o'clock. What about you,
Seems
George?
A bit early. Well, since I moved to Spain, 4 o'clock's a bit early for tea. But it doesn't matter when it is, but keeping it regular, keeping it routine, setting up activities that children feel comfortable with and that parents feel comfortable with. A really nice ready-to-go resource for this, Sarah?
It's, in fact, this list of learning activities based on over 30 days. It's great because it shows it gets the parent to think about a different activity for each day. And we can see it a bit better here. So each day has an activity. I like day five, when you have to draw your dream house and put what's inside it, but that's just one example. And of course, some of the days actually have an embedded link, because this is an interactive PDF. So the parent or the child can click on the activity like this, and up comes the activity. And so the material's ready to use.
And this is a lovely example. This would be what, a 5-10 minute activity, keeping it regular, keeping it embedded a certain time in the day, or move the time around. It's up to you. People have tea at different times. So we've got the place, we've got some routine and some time. What do we need now? So we need to really think, I think, oh God, that's terrible English, about what we're aiming for. In lots of my other sessions, I really try and push teachers to make it very clear to the students what our target is. And I think in this situation, making parents as clear as possible about this as well will help. You could use the CEFR, a monster, very useful document, which outlines very clearly what is expected of each student, what each student is expected to be able to do at each level, from A1 all the way up to C2. We have our own pre-A1, A1 and A2 set of, Sarah?
Child-friendly can-do statements.
Can-do statements. The CFR is also made up of can-do statements, which I really like. Can-do, not can't-do. And as you can see here, we have 10 can-do statements for pre-A1, 10 for A1 and 10 for A2, covering different skills, and they're very child and parent friendly. Simple, sorry, the builders have just started outside.
Oh dear.
Nice, so, visual supports. Yeah, sorry, carry on, Sarah, carry on.
I was just going to say, here's some examples you can see for starters, for pre-A1 starters. So understanding simple sentences. George?
Yeah, understanding and following simple instructions.
Recognizing simple descriptions.
That's fine, that's fine. I interrupted. Recognizing and writing the letters of the alphabet. Moving on to A1, copying phrases and short sentences. Nice, structured can-do statements. A1, asking someone how they are, what they like doing.
And we've got writing short sentences about what they like or dislike.
Some more for A1, telling a simple story with the help of pictures, and another 10 for A2 flyers. And we can pick these out depending, obviously, on the level of the students and on the parents. We've picked a few very simple ones out just to help with vocab more than anything. So what do we have, Sarah?
We've selected these. So looking at writing letters and the English alphabet, so an opportunity to think about spelling and writing. And of course, we have some vocabulary, so vocabulary topics, and also some nice scaffolded writing tasks, like copying words or phrases like these.
Which takes us on very nicely to the meat of the presentation, vocab. Little ones, I think, at home, help from parents, the most useful activities and the most useful thing parents can do is to support and help them build, review and play with their vocabulary.
And it's great.
I think we have a...
Because you can make them fun. Sorry, George. Yes, you can just...
Exactly. I think we have a link to the certificate popping up next, but please stay with us. So we're going to take you through the free resources from Cambridge, directed at teachers, and then look at some ways to adapt those or combine those with other free resources online, make them parent friendly, and we'll start from the little and move up to the big.
So we start with word level, so with flashcards. And as you will see on the screen, we've got a series of flashcards for each level based on the young learner word lists, and each topic is included in that. And we'll just have a look at an example taken from starters. So this is the PDF for the flashcards for A1 starters, PO1 starters. And here we have some examples. So we've got words from the zoo, so pictures.
Have you ever seen a sheep in the zoo, Sarah?
No, actually, only in a wildlife park, actually.
I might have seen quite an exotic sheep in a zoo,
yes,
perhaps.
That's true. Interesting. But they're quite international animals. They're quite international animals here, which is great.
Yeah.
And we've got the words to go. And the parents, if they can obviously print these out, cut them up, and do tasks with their child. For example, very simply, pick the picture, match it with the word. And if the word and the picture are the same, the child can indicate it's a yes. And if the picture and the word don't match, then it's going to be a no. Now, of course, you can do this online, or if you're in back in the face-to-face classroom, you might make it into a fun activity where they jump when it's right and they touch the floor when it's wrong. Whatever, you can do variations on it.
Now, Sarah said, these can be printed out and chopped up. We all know how well younger learners interact with physical objects, and pieces of flashcards are wonderful. We've had lots of flashcards are wonderful in the chat, which is great. But a nice way to develop this online, Sarah?
Is, of course, actually to look at digital flashcards. And here's an example, a free app called Quizlet. If you don't know, it's really fantastic. It's one of my favorites. And as you can see, you have a picture on one side. You click and you get the word on the other side. If you click the word, you get the picture. So you get the idea. So it's obviously a digital flashcard. There are collections of words. It's important to say that this actual example wasn't created by us. So as a teacher, you need to check the vocabulary in the list. So many teachers are sharing their material in the Quizlet website. So it's always a good idea just to check that it's the vocabulary that is appropriate for your students. And of course, you can actually make your own list. But if you haven't got time, it's definitely worth looking at the ready-made lists. And of course, apart from using them as flashcards, you can also get parents to use the learn option. And the learn option allows the children to see a picture of the object. And as you can see underneath, they have to choose the right word.
Lovely multiple choice task, which we all love as English teachers. And this is all ready to go. Another great resource, Sarah?
Is WordWall, a bit similar to Quizlet, but has a wider variety of activities, or a different variety. Here's an example of the quiz. So obviously the child gets the word and has to identify the correct image.
Well done, Sarah. Congratulations.
Thank you, George. And of course, what's nice about this is that you can obviously look at topic groups. Here is a match-up activity. So that's a drag and drop. Basically, the child is putting the picture against the word. But what I like about this is, and George was talking about the importance of repetition, and also the importance of making this fun, is that you can use the same word set, but with a variety of activities. You only need to click on one of these, and it will automatically produce the activity in a different format. So we've got here match up on screen, but you could do find the match, or you could do the quiz that we saw earlier, or a game show version of it, which is great fun as well.
Variety. Sorry, I was just going to drop it. Repetition and variety. Keeping things different. You don't have to keep them too different for six-year-olds. Forget after a few days. But repetition and variety.
But repetition, so you can do the same thing again, which is nice. And it's once it's stored, of course, you've got easy access to it, and so have the parents. And of course, you can also print it out as a printable. So if you want to have a paper version, you can actually do that too. So very flexible app. And not to forget the Word Fun World app. This is a great new app as well, available from Cambridge University Press. It's free. The children can hear the word, they can match the word, and they can actually create a little dictionary of the words that they've done. And they can do activities, timed activities as well. So lots of things there.
Lovely. So moving on from flashcards up to word lists, this is very sort of teacher focused, but it has its uses. We have published word lists for pre-A1 starters, about 450, A1 movers, about 750, and A2 flyers, around 1,200, I think. This is free to download as well. And there's a really nice additional resource, Sarah?
Indeed, there is. To go with word lists, there are some word list picture books which have taken some of the topics and obviously illustrated in the picture book, and they're available for all three levels. So again, another resource to refer to.
What's lovely for you as teachers in the word list, you have all of the word lists printed alphabetically, all levels, then each level alphabetically, and most usefully, I think, Sarah?
The topic lists. Fantastic. So each of the topics for each level has its own separate list, and we can actually have a look at an example.
Ooh, so we have three of our flashcards from earlier. Can you tell what they are, Sarah? We'll wait and see. Use this in combination with the word lists?
So here's our word list. So we've taken some of the words from that word list, and we've actually taken five. So here we go. We get the children to identify the word, so match the word with a picture with the flashcard. And then, of course, George, what else could they do?
They could draw flashcards. You could ask them to choose two extras and then draw their own flashcards. Or you could ask the parents to draw them. How are your drawing skills, Sarah?
Not so good. What about you, George?
I was asked a couple of weeks ago by a very small person to draw a dog. And having finished, she said, no, a dog. I think I'm more of a wordy person, to be honest. So we've extracted our five animals. Okay. What could we do next?
Well, we could do something very simple. Ask the children to put the words in alphabetical order.
Ooh. Well done, Sarah. Congratulations. And then?
And then, of course, we could also think about size and get the children to put them from biggest to smallest animals.
Or smallest to biggest, depending which way around you hold the list, I suppose. So really easy, quick activities that parents can, regardless of their level, really. Combining flashcards and word lists, and they're fun. So where are we heading now? Back to the flashcards. Yeah, combining these free resources, and they are initially aimed at teachers, but pass them on and give the parents a little bit of structure. And as we said, it doesn't need to be, you don't need to reinvent the wheel with young learners. It needs to be colourful, fun, repetitive. A really nice resource, once you've got the word list, Sarah. Sorry, I've forgotten what
That's
I was saying
okay.
for a second.
Yes, is FlipityNet. So if you want to create your own puzzles and word games, then FlipityNet is also free. And you can see a variety of some of the activities that Flippity offers. So you can actually create your own with words that are relevant to the level, take them from the word list and make something yourself.
Yeah, and if you copy and paste the word lists by level into a spreadsheet, Flippity will just instantly turn these from a spreadsheet into various word games. So it's a great resource to use. Then you can send the links on to parents. I think we have some examples next.
Yes, this is one we made earlier. As you see, we're looking at words for the doctor. Flippity takes the words, makes the word search, and gives you the key. Now, these are designed actually to be printed out rather than actually digital. But of course, if you are using them online, you can display them on the screen. So either print them out or display them. So yeah, absolutely great. And of course, you can choose the words that are relevant to your children.
So we've gone from flashcards to word lists to one of my favourite resources. These are all available to download as well. Classroom posters, pegged at each level. If parents can print these out and put them in the learning space, if not, get them in your classrooms. They're all very carefully designed to heavily feature vocabulary at level. So this is an A1 movers by the look of it. You can, a host of activities you can do with this and your flashcards. A really nice one, we could start just getting the students to extract some vocab. So we could start with food and drink, Sarah.
So yeah, here we go. Some
cup,
examples.
Cheese.
Here.
Are you a fan of cheese?
I love cheese. Do
I'm
you, George?
I'm an enormous fan of cheese, yes. Vegetables. And then we can move on from food and drink to
places. So we've got a supermarket. We've got a library, we've got the shopping centre, and of course we've got the cafe.
And then, after nouns?
Why not look at some verbs? So here we've got some examples of verbs. So someone's buying something, and here we've got them carrying, a very helpful little boy, helping his mother, and then of course...
You could try and pull some adjectives out as well. At this level, probably big, small, and colours. But once we've extracted this language, this is a lovely activity from Anne Robinson, who I think is speaking on Thursday. Once we've pulled the vocab out of the poster, next slide, I think, once we've got everything together, to extend this, especially for A1, you can get your students to write little sentences using the vocab that they've extracted. A really nice face-to-face activity from Anne Robinson is to give students a timed activity. Give them a minute, 2 minutes, with a few post-it notes. You have to stick up as many post-it notes with the words that they know on the poster. You could do that online with Annotate, I think, Sarah.
Yeah, Annotate allows you, the children can then actually write on the whiteboard on screen and again write the words that they know on from the poster.
And we have lots of other posters available. I think we move on to another movers poster.
Mm-hmm. And what's nice about these, obviously they're thematically based, related to the word list, but also related to the flashcards. And you can also see that the poster provides an opportunity for some language practice, which if it's on the poster, the student will keep seeing it. And that's, of course, a bit about the repetition. And as I said, it's thematically based and also links to the flashcards, as we can see.
So they match up with the flashcards. It's all ready to go. So there was a quick look.
Yeah.
There are lots of posters. There was a quick look at some of the resources originally aimed more at teachers that I'm sure you can pass on to parents, regardless of their level. So we'll now move on to look at some of the other resources aimed more directly at parents and candidates.
Yep.
So Sarah, firstly.
So we've got lots that we can direct our parents to on the website. So we've got this downloadable booklet, which has activities to try at home. So if the parent does have some English, they can actually have the booklet. Otherwise, you as teachers might extract some of the activities and pass them on to parents, perhaps in a different way, using the same ideas. What about this one, George?
Yeah, we have a tips and advice area on the website. This, again, probably a bit more aimed at teachers, but there is a blog on how parents can support English language learning. More ideas for you there. As I said, the links to these will be on the PDF that you'll get access to later.
So information for parents also in the blog section on the website, and we've got lots of practical simple suggestions, and there's a little on the next screen you can see some of those activities to do at home. But, and as George was saying, trying to do a little and often, and you can do very simple activities such as when you're getting dressed, they practice the word clothes vocabulary when they're getting dressed, for example. And one of my favorites is actually the workout in English, which takes you to this website.
Have you done a workout in English with Andy, Sarah?
Well, I have to say, I did try it out. He's very enthusiastic, and he takes you to the Arctic.
Looks very enthusiastic.
And he also takes you to the African savannah.
And he's wearing the same clothes in Africa as he is in the Arctic, which we wouldn't recommend for our younger students, perhaps. Moving on, we have really nice summaries. I think they're coming next.
Yes,
on Sarah.
These are interactive PDFs, and there's one for each level. Obviously, it's showing you some of those activities that we saw during the session, the word list, the posters, the flashcards, and you can go directly to them, and of course, activities for at home and to support parents. And these are available at the three levels. So it's nice and focused and takes you directly to those resources.
And I don't think I mentioned at the beginning, a lot of the stuff we've been looking at has been for young learners' exams, but it doesn't matter if your children are preparing or not for the exams. They're all based on those can-do statements we looked at, a very even spread of general English included in the exam. So all of these resources are useful, whether preparing or not. We have an activities for children section available on the website with a variety of activities that they can practice all four skills at home. I think these are all designed to be used on computer or a tablet.
Mm-hmm. And one of my
favorites. Oh, and Sarah's favorite. Sorry, Sarah's favorite.
Sarah's favorite, yes, of course, is singing, and for the young learners at pre-A1 and A1 particularly. And there's a series of different songs, obviously related to the vocabulary topics, and there are lyrics and learning activities that you can do with them, of course, with the emphasis on fun, and with a variety of skills being practiced. What's nice about this is what you see on the screen. And we can also, it becomes a kind of karaoke, so they can see the words, they can sing along, And
some parents might not be thanking you after a few weeks of the same song over and over and over again. But there's also a supplementary support booklet, I think.
That's Sarah? Right. So if they want to use the songs, then there's some guidance for parents or teachers. Again, you can extract suitable activities to send to your parents.
And lastly, we still have a few apps available aimed at young learners on the App Store, Monkey Puzzles, Shop and Drop. I'm not sure if Sing and Learn, is there an app version, Sarah?
No,
I'm not sure either.
It's on the link on the website.
Keep them playing, keep them having fun, repetition, and variety.
Yeah, and of course you've got the Word of World Fun app as well.
Yes, which we mentioned earlier.
Yeah, okay.
So I think that's pretty much it. The three things we want you to take away, apart from lots of resources, I hope we have managed to direct you to some things you didn't know about. A lot of them have been around for a while, a bit tricky to find. They're a lot easier to find now. But I think what's really important is having a place for learning English, a learning space for English if they are still working from home, and the time, keep the routine. Having a 10 minutes for English every day will help them immeasurably. And lastly, Sarah?
As George said, repetition, and to help parents make sure that children recycle, redo, repeat activities to help them feel confident and motivated in their learning of English. We hope the resources that we've shown you will show parents that they can do it. There are things that will help them help their children and enjoy their learning journey.
And as we said, we don't need to reinvent the wheel. Simple, replicable and varied will help enormously, we think. So thank you. I think we have time for some questions now. We finished a little bit earlier than we planned, Sarah. That was impressive. Maybe it was the nerves.
Okay, thank you very much, Sarah and George. I hope you can hear me.
Hi, Simona.
Yes, we can.
I'm very sorry. I had some unexpected technical problems, so I failed to introduce you properly at the beginning of our session. So I'm very sorry about that, but I'm sure you did the best introduction of yourselves possible. I've had a look at the questions we have. There are plenty of questions in the Q&A box, but many of them, maybe you'd like to repeat what I know that you've already mentioned that, but many questions are coming in about where exactly the teachers can find the resources you showed, in particular the PDFs and the posters. So if you could say a few words about that, just to clarify once again.
Sarah?
Okay, well, actually, you will be getting this in the PDF, but if you go to the website under the learning resources section, you can access that. You will actually see when you go into the website at the moment, access to my classroom, that will take you to a selection of resources as well. So there are lots of different ways to access it. So if
you can go by exam, young learners preparation, that will take you there. And also World of Fun from Cambridge University Press is a wonderful resource full of everything. So I would probably make that your first stop, World of Fun, and that will take you through.
Okay, thank you. And anyway, there were quite a few participants who worried that they hadn't caught a particular website that you mentioned after another one. So don't worry, everyone. There will be recordings of all the sessions, so you'll be able to go back to the recording to the session that you attended and you'd like to find out more and track down the links and the websites that were mentioned. We have a question here because you finished with some resources and ideas for how to involve parents. One question that came in is, what level of English do you think parents should have for the resources that you showed?
Should I
start? Sarah?
Okay, I was going to say, well, some of the resources you can actually use even with a very low level of English, because they're obviously, you've got the answer. So, for example, the matching activities, you can actually see the words. So parents can be confident that some of them, even if their English is not very strong, that they will be able to do some of these activities. What do you think about that, George?
Yeah, I agree. And some of the other ones we looked at towards the end, tips for parents and how to help your child, they're not hugely wordy. So if necessary, you as teachers could extract what is necessary and pass that on, which I know is extra work for you, but in some cases, I think that could be useful.
And often parents are asking teachers, what can I use? So it's very nice actually if teachers know what resources are available so they can direct that parent to those resources. So again, that relationship between the parent and the teacher, this can be an opportunity to make that into something that help the child in their learning process.
That's right, thank you. It seems we have quite a few participants who are both teachers and parents. So they have a double interest in this session. One of them is asking us about their first grader kid who cannot follow the instructions and gets lost. Would you have any suggestions to such a parent and teacher?
I think creating routines and doing activities again and again so that the child gets the confidence. So as they slowly become understand the activity, and they may need to have it explained more than once, but then they, if the parent can help them achieve, then I think slowly the child will become more confident, more able to do an activity.
Yeah, and I think trying to maintain a balance of, or like multi-mode input on tasks as far as possible. So trying to involve written instructions, spoken instructions, videos, a lot of visual input, and try to keep that balance. It's very important in class so that we're catering for all of our students, but I think perhaps trying different approaches to input and to delivering the instructions could help there.
And also including kinesthetic activities, because of course with younger learners, often that's in the classroom perhaps don't think so much. Yeah, so simple things like this and that. Yeah, absolutely, George. So I think it's important to make sure that we involve as many senses as possible also in the learning process.
Mm-hmm. And would you have any suggestions, any advice about the optimal age to start teaching English to your own kids? How young or how old should the kids be?
I don't think there's any one answer to that question. I think as young as possible. Exposure is important, as young as possible and as practical, really. I think there are lots of different arguments within this area. What do you think, Sarah?
No, I think it's about exposure. It's not about trying to teach grammar and rules, but it's actually allowing children to have fun with English, to do activities that they might enjoy as a game. And they're not even thinking about learning the language. They're picking it up. They're enjoying playing with the language as well. So very mm-hmm. practical, but not just about rules and regulations. No, that's not going to help.
And a teacher here is asking, how would you compare the time for class online versus on site? Is it okay to keep students sitting down for a whole hour in front of a computer? What do you think?
I would say 50 minutes maximum if you have an hour slot, and then at least you're allowing time for, especially if it's 26-year-olds, 7-year-olds sitting down and getting ready. I'd say the optimal time is 40, 45 minutes, to be honest.
But
if you have
George,
restraints, well, it depends. If there are external restraints you can't control, actual material for teaching and activities, I'd plan for 35 minutes, something like that, Sarah, don't you think?
And I think it's also to do with the age, but I also think it depends on the range of activities that you use in the lesson. Obviously, it's going to be particularly important to make sure you're breaking up activities, doing short spurts. Obviously, it's more difficult for younger students to sit there for an hour, so it may not be appropriate. So the younger they are, then maybe you might be looking at a shorter lesson. But certainly, it's about variety and making sure that they're doing different things, that perhaps if they can do a stand-up activity, if they can do a drawing activity, etc., so that you've got that variety as well.
I think at all levels, working online, staging is much more important. You have to think a lot more carefully about it, about setting up activities, how much time is going to be useful. I've done sessions with teachers in breakout rooms, and I give them 7 minutes, and 15 easily. So the more we teach, the more used to how long things take, we become. Was that a sentence? Yeah. But I think being very clear, it does. And being very clear about your staging, how you deliver instructions, how you're going to check those instructions have been understood. I think it's inevitable. We do have to plan more and plan for things taking longer than they would face to face.
And I think we have to keep an eye on the technology as well. So during the lesson, there may be certain points in the lesson where it's worth checking that they can still hear you or see you. Just to remember that's important to include feedback from the students that they're still with you. And that could be showing a hand rather than doing something digital. So you can actually see them doing something as well, if you're able to use cameras, of course, depending on your platform.
Well, thank you. Quite a few ideas and connected to what you've just been saying, not using only one type of instructions written or doing some stand-up tasks. One participant was asking all these nice ideas about singing, learning the language through songs, but would you have any ideas if singing happens to be forbidden in the school?
Now that's very interesting. Silent singing, you can mouth the song. You could do action
mime,
to a song.
Definitely mime, yeah.
Mime a song. You can mime
find a good song with lots of nice verbs in it.
And this might definitely be something that they do with their parents, because they might be able to sing at home if they can't sing it in the classroom. So of course, I appreciate that would depend on your circumstances. So yes, of course, we have to consider that.
Mm. And a really nice for higher level students from a colleague of mine, David, was giving groups of students a word. I think it was Love Actually that he used. Every time Christmas was mentioned, all the boys had to stand up. And every time something else, I can't remember, all the girls had to stand up. So that would be quite a nice way of ensuring that they are understanding and interacting with an audio or a video, hopefully in silence, if silence is
and extending what we're aiming for. If you can't stand up, you could do it with a post-it. So if you hear the word, you illustrate it with a post-it. So very practical. So extending that idea further.
And finally, I think that would be the last question for today. We know, and you have presented so many nice platforms and websites where teachers can design their own activities, and you showed not very nice examples. But would you recommend, off the top of your heads, an easy test-making tool where the teachers can design some easy quizzes? Very practical and without requiring too much technical knowledge.
There are several, aren't there, George?
I think you also mentioned some.
I'm going to mention, well, Quizlet in itself is a kind of, you can test that way, if you like, in that sense. Perhaps you could use Google Forms to create your own test, and they auto marks, which is the advantage of that. George?
That's a little more complicated. Kahoot is great. Mm-hmm. And there are lots of ready-to-go Kahoots, which you can find on our website. There's a session on that at some point. I love Word Wall. The ones we spoke about, Flipperty, Quizlet, Word Wall, need very little technical knowledge. And if we're just testing vocab, for example, at lower levels, as I said, if you get your lists of vocab together, you put it in once, and it can reformulate in lots of different guises, quizzes, crosswords, etc. And with WordWall and Quizlet, there's so much stuff ready to go designed by other teachers. Yep. So I would have a look at those.
Well, thank you very much. It seems we've covered quite a lot today. I hope everyone is taking away quite a few ideas to apply well, at home with their own kids or in the classroom. Sarah and George, thank you very much for a very nice, very entertaining and very informative presentation. And we look forward to watching some more exciting sessions in the Cambridge Live event.
Thank you. Thank you all very much. Thank you, Sarah. Thank you, Simone.
Thank you.
And everyone behind the scenes as well.
Yes. That's right. Thank you.
Joining us today. Thank you.
Have a lovely time. Thanks.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.